Hello everyone and welcome back to the final list video, and in this one I'm finally gonna talk about my top 50 albums of 2022. In 2022 I ended up not really investing that much in albums in comparison to previous years, but I still ended up finding 50 albums that I really like and I do recommend to you to check out. And yeah, this is gonna take a while, so let's just jump straight into it. At number 50 we have Astral Fortress by Darkthrone. This is actually an album that I ended up not making a review out of it, mainly because this album feels pretty similar to some of the stuff that we've gotten out of Darkthrone in recent years. It's another blend of black metal with doom and heavy metal, and it's a nice combination of sounds overall. I believe that it makes for some of the most solid stuff Darkthrone have put out, and this particular album didn't really have something all that new or different to it, and so I didn't really feel that I had that many things to add about this particular album in order to make a full review out of it. I personally prefer it in comparison to the previous album that they've put out, and I believe that Astral Fortress in general has some pretty good ideas, but for the most part, yeah, we're talking about a pretty standard album in this new era of Darkthrone. At number 49 is God's Country by Chad Pyle. This was a really engaging album that I got into it not necessarily knowing what to expect out of it, but I like the very heavy atmosphere out of this one, especially when it comes to the vocal performances, which sound really harrowing, and in general it's a pretty brutal album with its sounds, its themes, its execution. It is a really solid noise rock album with sludge metal elements, and yeah, I believe that there are some great aspects about it. Number 48 is Exister by The Soft Moon. Weirdly enough, this brand new The Soft Moon album is extremely varied. It goes into many different directions and styles that we've seen from The Soft Moon over the years, but it also feels really familiar to the extent that it doesn't necessarily make for one of my favorite, and certainly not for one of the most consistent releases. But if you're looking for a more intense, dark and sort of experimental approach when it comes to darkwave and post-punk music, also giving a bit of a more emphasis to industrial elements, then I believe that there are some really great aspects about this particular album. Number 47 is King's Disease 3 by Nas. One of the most legendary rappers period makes the third installment out of this series, and in my opinion this is by far the best work. I personally was a little bit indifferent when it comes to King's Disease 1 and 2, which felt like pretty standard and basic albums when it comes to hip hop, and it's not like this one in particular had anything all that special about it, but it was the one that ended up clicking with me when it comes to some of the instrumentals, some of the deliveries. It was an album that I ended up finding a lot of enjoyment out of it, and even if it's a bit lengthy and it has tracks that don't really shine all that much, in general it is certainly one of my favorite Nas releases, especially in recent memory. Number 46 is Actual Life 3 by Fred Again. In my opinion, this is the greatest work when it comes to full-length albums of Fred Again. I was hoping that we would get even more energetic directions like we got with the USB EP, but there is still a bit of a change of pace when it comes to this particular album, and it also feels quite consistent with some really solid elements and very nice instrumentals and an overall nice use of vocal samples and effects throughout this whole thing. So when it comes to an electronic and dance release, this is certainly one of my strongest recommendations out of the previous year. Number 45 is The Liquefied Throne of Simplicity by Serum. This was a very intriguing release of avant-folk and post-minimalism that has world and ethnic elements that are blended in a really nice way with very lengthy songs that managed to have some pretty solid ideas to them that made for what is undoubtedly one of the most intriguing albums I've heard the previous year. It has very lengthy tracks, it can be chaotic at times, but when it clicks, it manages to show its strengths in terms of performances and experimentation. Number 44 is His by Wormrot. When it comes to grindcore, this is easily one of my strongest recommendations, and I believe that this is the case for lots of people. Also blending elements of hardcore punk and power violence, it actually manages to be one of the most accessible albums and one of the easiest ones to get you started into the genre. With very solid and pristine production and some really nice performances and technical elements, His is another strong pick in Wormrot's catalog. Number 43 is Geisha Girl with Anatole Jerry. This album is a blend of Anatolian rock, psychedelic rock with Turkish traditional music and also with a couple of electronic elements here and there, and it sounds really really good. It's one of those albums that I didn't really expect I would end up liking as much as I did, but yeah, I believe that this is certainly one of the most intriguing and one of the most unique blends of sounds that I've heard, and it works really nice over here, so I strongly recommend this album. Number 42 is Synchro Anarchy by Voivod. Even though I'm not really that much into thrash metal music, the technical thrash elements of Voivod always manage to keep me hooked, and it's nice that after all of those years, the more progressive metal elements and technical thrash elements that we see with Synchro Anarchy still manage to make for a really impressive album, and one that has ended up being a grower on me, and I would possibly consider this one of my favorites when it comes to the overall Voivod catalog, really liking the results out of this one. Number 41 is Bad Mode by Hikaru Tada. It's actually a bit of impressive how much this album ended up blowing up in certain circles. I believe that it also has to do with certain intriguing producers placed in tracks out of this album, but the thing is that Hikaru Tada, after all of those years, has still got it. Her voice is beautiful, it is impressive, and in general I believe that this is a really solid J-pop album with very nice electronic instrumentals, managing to have both moody and cheerful aspects, and in general, it's a really engaging album. Once again, really solid work from Hikaru Tada over here. Number 40 is Exorcism by Sidewalks and Skeletons, one of my favorite artists when it comes to Witch House, and I wouldn't consider this to be one of my favorite works since I have been really impressed with some of the stuff that he's put out in the past, but regardless, this still manages to be another really solid work from Sidewalks and Skeletons and a great album when it comes to Witch House. Number 39 is Remember Rainbow Bridge by Croatian Amor, an album that has not managed to be that much of a grower on me as time goes on, but I still certainly like the chill atmosphere that it creates. It's calm, it's moody at times, and it has some pretty solid electronic elements. If you're looking for an ambient trance, an ambient techno album, then this is a strong recommendation for me. Number 38 is Sewer Bait by JK Flesh. Now we go into a much darker and brutal direction when it comes to electronic and dance music. JK Flesh has certainly paved the path when it comes to gritty industrial techno music over the years, and Sewer Bait keeps with those slow, heavy and minimal songs that simply just get the job done. There is nothing particularly special about it, but it's still pretty solid. Number 37 is Music for Animals by Nils Fram. While this is a massive album and it requires a bit of patience in order to get through all of this, it ends up being rewarding as I find this to be one of my favorite recent Nils Fram releases. It is a very beautiful and soothing minimal ambient album with electronic and classical compositions, and overall I find this to be a really cool project. Number 36 is Vitalik's Dissidence Episode 2, which in my opinion it's an improvement in comparison to the first episode, which ended up feeling slightly all over the place and not containing some of my favorite elements when it comes to the sounds of Vitalik. On the other hand, this album feels a bit more consistent and containing some more energetic elements that also bring me back to some of the stuff out of the early era of Vitalik, which in my opinion were really impressive. It is not a spectacular album, but it's still a great electro house release. Number 35 is Chet by Rammstein. In terms of a Rammstein album, this is pretty standard. You get your typical Neue Deutsche Harte and industrial metal formula that Rammstein have managed all over those years to create some of the most well-known and most influential stuff in the genre. This album over here is not an exception, while I don't believe that it's one of the greatest Rammstein works because it doesn't really have something particularly all that different or unique or special about it, it still gets the job done and there are some solid tracks over here. Number 34 is King Gizzard and the Lizard Wizard with Omnium Gatherum. This is the first time after all of those years that I end up finally enjoying a work of King Gizzard and the Lizard Wizard to that much of an extent. I've never really managed to be that much into their works. While there have been tracks that I really enjoy, when it comes to a full-length album, I've always struggled to really find the appeal. Omnium Gatherum feels like a combination of all of the stuff that I've done over the years, also including directions like some hip-hop stuff that I wasn't necessarily expecting, but yeah, this is an album that goes into many different styles of electronic and rock music, and while it's really chaotic and really lengthy, in my opinion it contains some of the best stuff I've heard out of the group. Number 33 is Azathoth by Flint Glass. If you're looking for a nice, dark ambient and electronic release with some minimal and chill beats, then I believe that this album is pretty interesting. Nothing particularly all that exceptional, but an enjoyable listen throughout.
Number 32 is Fossora by Björk.
After being somewhat disappointed by some of the latest stuff out of Björk, I ended up finding a lot of enjoyment out of this album, still managing after all of those years to create unique, refreshing and experimental stuff. This fusion of art pop with choral and also some gabber elements makes for an intriguing combination of sounds where once again the vocals are spectacular, Björk's voice is once again amazing, and in general it's an album that, while it has its shortcomings, I find this to be one of my favorite directions when it comes to some of the latest stuff out of Björk. Number 31 is the self-titled Final Light. This album has many similar directions to Perturbator's Last Full Sacraments, and so it ends up feeling more of like a Perturbator album at the end of the day, but the fusion of synthwave with more rock and metal elements is actually a direction that works really well for the sound of Perturbator over here, and with this collaboration with the vocalist of Cult of Luna, it makes for a pretty intriguing album, not one that I would necessarily say that I love it, but one that was certainly really good for what it offered. Number 30 is Disciples of Excremental Liturgies by Mnima. One of the nastiest and noisiest black metal albums I've heard out of the previous year, this is an extremely raw sound over here that manages to be really powerful. It's in your face and absolutely brutal, to the point where the noisy parts might not be that much to your liking if you're not really that much familiar with a more black noise direction like what this album is, which I believe it does a really good job for what it is. It's not particularly a sound that I'm that much into, but I believe Mnima did a really good job with this particular album. Number 29 is The Gleam by Park Jeha. Easily one of the more special traditional music releases out of the previous year, one that has a really nice blend of Korean traditional music with post-minimalism and some avant-folk elements. The album is varied, quite imaginative and experimental at points. And yeah, I believe that this is a pretty interesting release. Number 28 is the new album of Vain, This World Is Going To Ruin You. After the success of Error Zone, which was considered one of the most essential metalcore and mathcore albums out of the previous decade, this new album didn't disappoint. While it's not as dense and complex as what we got with the more intense stuff out of the first album, this one still manages to be kick-ass, really energetic and powerful, and in general being a really solid metalcore album in a genre that I'm not that much into, but really liking the stuff out of Vain. Number 27 is this collaboration of Bastard Noise and Merzbow with the album Retribution by All Other Creatures. I believe that in terms of noise music, this is some of the coolest stuff that we've gotten from both of those artists in a while. There are some really solid production choices, noise textures, and pacing throughout this album, especially when it comes to the first track, which I find to be excellent, even though the rest of the album doesn't really manage to keep up with the excitement that the very first song created, it still makes for what is arguably one of the best noise releases out of the previous year. Number 26 is Grand Theft Auto with Pass Me The Cons. After almost 2 decades of absence, this is certainly not one of the groups that I would end up making a comeback, but I personally really enjoyed the very first album of Grand Theft Auto, which screamed early 2000s vibes with a blend of alternative rock and industrial music. This one is not really that much of an intense album, but it still had some really catchy, energetic and cool moments, so if you're looking for an alternative rock album that also goes a little bit into directions of like Big Beat and other electronic stuff, then I can say that this album is pretty fun. Number 25 is Les Ruinas by Reconasty. I personally haven't really managed after all of those years to be really that much invested into a full-length Reconasty project. While there have been tracks that I've loved out of Reconasty and I like her flows and deliveries, I've always seen the potential, but it's the first time after all of those years, after so many projects, where I can finally say that I found a really consistent album that has many solid moments from start to finish. It is a huge mess of an album going from hardcore hip-hop to industrial hip-hop to even drum and bass stuff to even a remix of Jungle by Fred Again. It's really all over the place, but I believe it's the first time where the more aggressive and experimental approach of Reconasty's music shines. It took a while to get an album like this, but it's finally here. Number 24 is Broken Gargoyles by Diamanda Galas. At this point, I don't really believe that there is more to say about Diamanda Galas. She's one of the most eccentric opera singers out there. Her insane vocal ranges and this wild, experimental, dark up in the drone album creates a horrifying, dark and eerie atmosphere that very few other artists manage to achieve the way Diamanda Galas does. This is a return to form with a very solid album in her career. Number 23 is Closer by Nasia. This is the third that what it seems the final album out of Nasia, and I'd say that this possibly has my favorite collection of songs, while I really love some of the tracks out of the first album much more. When it comes to a more consistent release, I believe that this one takes the cake. With a lengthy and polished neurofunk release, insanely good production, really catchy and energetic, and while it has some shortcomings here and there since we're talking about a lengthy and kinda messy album, for the most part it's really solid. Number 22 is Platinum Scatter by Current Value. Definitely one of the most unique and one of the most refreshing albums I've heard out of the previous year, Current Value still manages, after all of those years of experimenting with drum and bass music, to still manage to create something that is unheard of. An album that pushes the boundaries in terms of drum and bass and creating a very glitchy and experimental album with mind-blowing production and some of the most chaotic tracks out of Current Value's entire catalog. While this album hasn't managed to addict me as much in comparison to other works, I find this to be certainly one of the most special and one of the most intriguing in his catalog. Number 21 is Palaces by Flume. Really inconsistent album in the sense that on some cases we get some tracks that sound like your average EDM songs, from the pacing, the deliveries of the features, which I wasn't really into this more commercial sound. On the other hand, I believe that Palaces contains not only some of the best stuff out of Flume's catalog, but some of the most mind-blowing and greatest electronic songs out of the previous year. Once again, production in this thing is absolutely spectacular, and when it comes to those tracks that feel more reminiscent to what he did with the mixtape Hi This Is Flume, this is where the album truly shines with some absolutely spectacular wonky stuff. At number 20 is Cheerleader by Grimm. This is another one of those albums from Grimm that are just absolutely brutal and menacing and contain some of my favorite elements when it comes to his sound. Really solid power noise with power electronics, intense noisy soundscapes, very harsh vocals, some weirdly catchy stuff with a beat here and there, but overall this is certainly one of the most intense releases out of the previous year. Number 19 is the return of Deathspell Omega with the album The Long Defeat, which interestingly enough is one of the weirdest and one of the most unique albums out of Deathspell Omega, which says quite something, as Deathspell Omega were known for just doing their own thing in terms of avant-garde black metal. I get it that some of the vocal directions and some of the instrumental choices might not be for everyone, but for me this is an album that really clicked, and I do like it for its risks and the approaches that it takes. Number 18 is Fascination by Pascal. Such a gorgeous dark wave and EBM album with solid atmospheres, some really cool scenes, and some really catchy and energetic beats for the most part. I got into this album not necessarily knowing what to expect out of it. I remember liking the previous Pascal album, but this one was certainly a grower. I saw myself just coming back to certain tracks, and when it comes to EBM and dark wave, this is a very strong recommendation for me. Number 17 is Kendrick Lamar's Mr. Morale and the Big Steppers. This was an album that I was certainly highly anticipating, and I was certainly not disappointed by the results. While it's a pretty busy album, and I'd say it was pretty inconsistent with certain tracks that could go into more pop rap directions that I didn't really enjoy as much, Kendrick Lamar also has some of the most personal, most heartfelt, and some of the most solid tracks in terms of creating those stellar cinematic performances. I believe that in certain cases, this album contains some of the greatest stuff I've heard out of Kendrick Lamar. This album would be even more magnificent if it wasn't for certain tracks, but regardless, this is still an essential hip-hop album. Number 16 is Diner Coffee by Mamalik, certainly one of the weirdest and one of the most experimental releases I've heard out of the previous year. Mamalik was mostly known as an avant-garde black metal band, but this album is certainly much more than that. This is like a blend of experimental rock with metal and jazz, and it's so all over the place. While in certain aspects it follows the formula of the previous album, I believe that there is a much better job done in here, with some heavily twisted and dark tracks with dense structures. This album is certainly very special if you're looking for a more experimental release. Number 15 is Black Banshee's Music for Menus. This is a change of pace from Black Banshee, as we don't get this vapor trap approach, which after a certain point it became kinda tiring, and while they did some experimentations with more minimal ambient stuff, I believe that this is the best executed result that we get over here. Music for Menus is minimal, calm and chill, and it has some great sound choices to it, and in my opinion this is possibly the greatest Black Banshee album. One that doesn't feel as standard if you are familiar with Black Banshee, but in my opinion this is the most polished one. Number 14 is the Runner soundtrack by Boy Harsher. I usually don't put soundtracks in lists with my top albums, but I'd say I make an exception out of this one since it's mostly original material done in a way that mostly feels like an album rather than just a collection of songs and sounds blending together. Here's the thing, you have two sides with this particular album. On one you have those more dark and horror synth stuff that are presented matching the dark and haunting tone of this short film, and on the other hand, you have some very catchy synthpop stuff with features to them, and they feel nothing like what you would expect from Boy Harsher, but I really like how unique and refreshing this album sounds for them. This very short album is great, it captures the aesthetics of the film in a really nice way, but even the standalone tracks, they're more than just serviceable. Number 13 is Ultratronic's by Ryoji Keda. I personally have been disappointed with some of the latest stuff of Ryoji Keda, which felt effortless to me. However, what we get with Ultratronic's instead is actually one of the most polished and well-crafted Ryoji Keda albums. This is a chaotic, obscure, experimental, electronic and ambient release that has many of the elements that has made the sound of Ryoji Keda appealing over the years, and we get a couple of the strongest highlights out of Ultratronic's, definitely one of the best Ryoji Keda releases in my opinion. Number 12 is New Religion Old Rules by J.K. Flesh, another album from J.K. Flesh, the second one in this list, and this one is simply so powerful, incredible, minimal and dark industrial techno release with some of the best stuff I've heard out of J.K. Flesh. This album is short, it's straight to the point, with great tracks and a fantastic heavy atmosphere to it from start to finish. Number 11 is Null by Ken Mode. I personally have been pretty intrigued with the sound of Ken Mode, especially with the album Loved, which was pretty dense and a pretty weird experience, but what we get with Null is an album that, while it's more straightforward, it works in its benefit in my opinion. It's a brutal, heavy, dark and punishing noise rock and sludge metal release with no wave, industrial and post-hardcore elements. This is a beast of an album and definitely one of my strongest recommendations if you're looking for a more extreme and intense sound. And now at the top 10, we start at number 10 with It's Almost Dry by Pusha T. He has really solid flows and deliveries and I really like the instrumentals that he raps into. While it's not as strong as Daytona, which for me it's one of the greatest hip-hop releases when it comes to the past decade, It's Almost Dry still contains some spectacular stuff. I don't believe that every single track works tremendously, but for the most part we get some really solid highlights over here. Number 9 is Rubber Rose by Kakola. This is certainly one of the most unexpected picks for me out of this year, as I've never really been that much into mashup albums, but this one was certainly an exception. It is a massive, extremely chaotic album with so many different samples, from mainstream pop, to rap, to rock ballads, to dubstep, even some more niche stuff into the mix. And the interesting thing is that you can't necessarily say that it's all just a novelty album. It's not necessarily an album that is always trying to make you laugh, it's just a really nice blend combination of sounds from so many different samples that, in a weird sense, they end up working together and blending in such a nice way. So I've never really been that much into mashups, but this is possibly one of the best stuff I've heard out of the genre. I really like this one. Number 8 is Howling by Linecraft, Japanese death industrial and power electronics artist that over the years has done some excellent stuff. In my opinion, this album contains what is undoubtedly some of the biggest highlights in his entire career, including certain tracks that I would say are some of the best I've heard in the genre in a while. It is such an incredible dark album with chaotic elements when it comes to the sampling in certain occasions, really haunting and sickening at times, definitely one of the best releases when it comes to some more underground, dark and extreme stuff. This is so well put together. Speaking of intense albums, at number 7 is the Masona and Prurient split Annihilationism, one of the most brutal and one of the most intense harsh noise releases out of the previous year. Incredible stuff from both Masona and Prurient going into their respective ways, managing to create an absolute intense, brutal and chaotic album, very short album, and it's just non-stop madness from start to finish. One of my strongest recommendations when it comes to extreme, brutal and harsh releases out of the previous year. Number 6 is the collaboration of Dennis Pant and John Weiss with The Echoing Cell. Definitely one of the most obscure and experimental albums out of the previous year, that is just an incredible combination of noise with free improvisation drumming and some of the most stellar production I've heard in terms of noise music. It is wacky, extremely chaotic and really out there, and some of the sounds and textures over here are absolutely incredible. Stellar release when it comes to production, sound choices, maybe a bit hard to get into if you're not into that much experimental and free improvisation stuff, but it's definitely worth checking out. I personally really love this release. At number 5 is The Split of Like Weeds and Bastard Noise, Human Free Eden. Another release that in my opinion is spectacular when it comes to its overall sound, production and textures. It's a brutal, relentless, harsh noise and power electronics release, and when it comes to the Like Weeds side, I believe that it contains some of the best stuff I've heard out of him. His side is extremely hard hitting and it sounds so good. Thankfully the Bastard Noise side manages to deliver as well, but yeah, when it comes to Like Weeds, he made an amazing job with this particular release. If you're looking for another underground noise release, this is possibly my strongest recommendation out of this year. Number 4 is New Confusion by Sit & Shine, possibly one of my favorite works out of Sit & Shine, and it says a lot because I believe that Sit & Shine have some amazing works under their belt. But New Confusion contains some of my favorite aspects out of the group, having this wacky and experimental approach with avant-garde, noise rock, electronic music and a heavy dose of sampling, loops and manipulation. While it's kind of familiar with certain Sit & Shine releases, it manages to be executed in one of the best ways over here, with a real consistent and really solid album from start to finish. Number 3 is my pick for the most relentless black metal release of the previous year, Bluetooth Nords, Disharmonium, Undreamable Abysses. They outdid themselves with this one, with what is arguably one of my favorite Bluetooth Nord releases, and undoubtedly my favorite black metal release out of this year, and it's possibly gonna be one of my favorites out of this decade. This one embraces in an amazing way this more Lovecraftian style, and what they did with Hallucinogen is heavily improved in an absolute beast of an album, with horrifying atmosphere, insanely sounding riffs, some intense and spectacular avant-garde drumming, and overall an outworldly experience. Absolutely incredible and powerful release over here. Number 2 is 24 by Minute Machine. After being heavily excited with the more EBM directions that we saw teased from previous releases of Minute Machine, I did not expect the results of the full-length album to be as strong as they are with 24. It is a really short album, but it's also heavily impactful, really straight to the point, with some amazing songs. The duo is catchier and more energetic than ever before, but they still manage to keep this more dark and moody atmosphere that is present once again over here, and it's done in an amazing way. Also, I'd say that this is my favorite in terms of vocal performances and also containing some of the best sound choices out of anything else Minute Machine have done over the years. This is an excellent and an amazing album, subverting all my expectations. And at number 1 it is an obvious pick, if you are familiar with my channel you all saw this coming, it is Black Country New Roads, Ants From Up There. My very first 10 out of 10 review out of this channel, a moment that is extremely rare for me since I very rarely put a 10 out of 10, especially in more recent albums. But I ended up having such a strong attachment with this particular release. It ended up feeling so special to me, which also seemed to be the case with so many other people. It is actually with very few occasions where I'm in such agreement over a highly praised album, thinking that it totally deserves it. But still, what makes an album a 10 out of 10 for me doesn't have to do with the performances, or the mixing, or the production, or the blend of sounds, the combination of genres, the technicality, the vocals, the lyrics, which all of them are spectacular, by the way. They're simply unmatched, and I can't believe how great this album sounds and how stellar the performances are. However, a 10 out of 10 is something that feels personal and it's hard to describe, and this is why I usually end up not recommending 10 out of 10 albums, because it's something that feels special to me to the point where it can't really feel that it can resonate in the same way that it did with me. Though there's possibly no need for me to recommend this album to you, you've probably already heard it, you're most likely already know about it if you're not living under a rock. It is in very few occasions where I'm so overwhelmed with emotions when listening to an album, and yeah, this is one of the very few cases where you will see me describe an album as a masterpiece and put the 10 out of 10 score. But in my opinion, Ants From Up There totally deserves it. And that's the list for my top 50 albums of 2022. What were your favorite albums out of the previous year? Let me know down in the comments. Leave a like if you enjoyed the video, subscribe for more content like this. Thank you for watching, I'll see you all in the next video. Goodbye.